सर विल स्टार्ट सर
हाँ ये सर प्लीज सर
सर गुड आफ्टरनून टू लर्नर्स टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग ऑन डिप्लोमा एंड अकाउंटिंग फोर ब्लॉक थ्री डिजोल्यूशन ऑफ ए पार्टनर दिस अ वेरी वेरी इम्पोर्टेंट एंड वेरी डिफिकल्ट टॉपिक तो यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड द कंसेप्ट वेरी रियली वेल एंड दिस ऑन दिस द पार्टनरशिप इज डिसॉल्व The partners is broken into different or different having a different name. The new partners may also admit, may also go, may retire, may die. So new firm name also arises in case of dissolution of partnership, and new partner also may come into account. So we'll start with the introduction. The dissolution of partnership and all the partners of firm is known as dissolution of firm. There is a two concept. One is dissolution of partners. And another is dissolution of the firm. The dissolution of the firm is under Section 39 of the Partnership Act 1932. So I have already discussed. It is Section. It is Partnership Act 1932. Till now, we have not made amendments of the Partnership Act 1932. We are following 1932, and we will be going. It is 2020, so it will be 100 years till that. The rule is same. The law is same. So when there is a dissolution of the partner, means after the four partners, suppose two or three partners get dissolved, may die, may leave the firm, the purpose may be over, the project may be over, the objective may be over, so they may leave the firm. Then the firm, the partners may leave. Then there is a dissolution of the partners takes place. When the dissolution of firm arises, means the business is closed down. Firm means the partnership firm. Or any time you take the dissolution of means the dissolution of the firm. Firm dissolution means the partnership dissolution. When the firm is dissolved, because inside a firm, when there is a firm inside that, the partners are there. The firm dissolved means automatically there is a dissolution of the partner. The partner dissolution means suppose after four partner, one partner died, then the ratio will be changing, the profit sharing ratio will change, the capital contribution will be also affected. So out of four partners, there may be three partners. So that the partners may get dissolved. So the dissolution of partnership among all the partners of a firm is called a partnership of a firm. If all the partners are dissolved, then the firm is also ultimately dissolved. It is as per Section 39 of the Partnership Act 1932. Dissolution of firm means complete breakdown of the relationship of partner and all the partners. The partnership agreement deed is broken down, and the relationship between all the partners is also broken up. And all the partners resolve to dissolve the partnership, the dissolution of firm takes place. How dissolution of partnership of firm takes place? Then all the partners agree to dissolve the partnership, then also dissolution of firm takes place. We can tell the firm. Firm is here, but the partnership firm is wound up. If the business comes to an end, it is said that the firm has been dissolved. Asset is less, liability is more. When the liability is more, the asset is less. The business has become insolvent, the firm has become insolvent, unable to pay, then we can tell the firm has been dissolved. Dissolution of firm means closing down the business. Firm dissolution implies partnership dissolution, but not vice versa. Again, I'm telling the partnership may be dissolved because one partner died, one partner may leave the organization, the partners may be dissolved. But when the partners are making the dissolve, out of three partners, one partner leave, one partner died, that does not mean the firm is dissolved. The remaining two partners can carry on the same business, the same ratio, or as for that, making amendment or changes in the partnership deed. And the firm name of the firm may be also, if the name of the firm is a neutral name, it may carry on. They may carry on the business. So the firm may not be dissolved. It depends on the partner, remaining partner. But when the firm is dissolved, all the partners automatically are dissolved. Coming to the causes of general dissolution, how dissolution takes place. The general dissolution of a partnership will also be investigated with the following reason. Before to this, I will only highlight what is the difference between dissolution of partners and dissolution of firm. One, two, three point I will tell. When there is a dissolution of partnership, the books of account may not be closed. I will also tell in detail in a letter, but I will only tell two, three points. When there is a dissolution of partnership, the books of accounts may not be closed. When there is a dissolution of firm, the books of account have to be closed. Same is case, when there is dissolution of partnership, does not mean dissolution of firm, I've already told. But when the dissolution of firm, it means the dissolution of partnership. So what are the ways on how the dissolution can take place? Dissolution can take place in a variety way. That are the varieties of way the dissolution can be take place. Number one, there may be mutual agreement. Dissolution, see, in a partnership which is created by an agreement, and then the partnership also can be dissolved by an agreement. And the firm is dissolved when the partner agree, and it should be dissolved. The partnership firm is the creation of agreement, we know, and the firm can be dissolved by an agreement. We are agreeing to form a partnership to the business, and we are agreeing to not to carry on the business, to dissolve the business, to end the business. Then it can be also dissolved. After such an event or after the purpose is over, the objective is over, then the agreement may be mutual. Number two, dissolution may take place by happening of some contingency. Some contingency event happened, like there are expiry of the term of duration of the firm or the completion of any adventure of the project and death of a partner, or by the partner is declared insolvent. One of the partners is declared insolvent, and dissolution can take place happening of some contingency. The other partner will write a notice to all other partners of the firm, and they will resolve, and they may dissolve the firm by serving a notice of partners as an action provided for in partnership agreement. This is the second point. Number third point, dissolution may take place by notice of partner at will. And you know what is partnership at will. As per his will, he may at any time he may dissolve the partnership firm. And the partnership's will, the firm may dissolve at any time by any partner giving notice to writing to all other partners of the business with their intention to dissolve the firm. The partnership agreement may be dissolved and the business should not be carried on. There may be some compulsory dissolution by operation of law. The firm may be dissolved in various ways. How? And all the partners accepted one become insolvent, all the partners become insolvent, business become insolvent, then the law tells us that. And when the another clause is very important, when number of partners exceed 20 in case of ordinary business, we know in case of ordinary business, it should not be more than 20. It exceed 20, and in case of banking, it should exceed 10, then or compulsory should be dissolved by law, because law tells that in case of banking, there should be maximum 10 partners. And in case of other business, ordinary business, there should be maximum 20 partners. If you go beyond that, then it may be compulsory dissolved by operation of law. Well, the point is the exercise of power in the legislation. That is very important. Dissolution by court. How the court may dissolution? If their partners have filed a case or suit against the other partners of the firm, the court may order the dissolution of firm in different way. Even the partner become unsound mind. And when the partner suffers from permanent incapacity and become incapable of performing duties as a partner, when a partner is guilty of misconduct affecting the business of the firm, when a partner commit willful or persistent breach of warranty, and a partner transfer the whole of the business interest to the third party, and when the business cannot be carried on except on a loss, and with this ground, the court may grant a dissolution by the partner to against all partners. So the firm may be dissolved. So the exercise was specific part in the partnership deed. For example, the partnership agreement allowed a majority of the partner to sue the dissolution. And other events for which providing the legislation is the death or bankruptcy partner, already I have discussed, fraud and misrepresentation, illegal activities, rescission by order of court, already I have discussed, the business may be carried out at a loss for a long period of time, is insolvent, then the business court may order for dissolution. This is a difference. I have discussed 2 points. Dissolution by partnership versus dissolution by firm. Very, very important. Say dissolution of partnership does not mean dissolution of firm, but dissolution of firm means dissolution of partnership. In case of dissolution of partnership, I have already discussed the banks of books of account may not be closed, but in case of dissolution of firm, the books of account would be closed. The dissolution of partnership among all the partnership known as dissolution of firm. And the dissolution of partnership implies a change in relationship partner, where the dissolution of firm amount to complete shutdown or closure of a business. If any of the partner dies or retire or become insolvent, but if the remaining partner still agree to continue the business of the firm, then it is dissolution of partnership, not partnership firm. Another thing I want to tell, which is not written in the PPT, I may tell simple point. The relationship may remain or may change, as the case may be, in case of dissolution of partnership. But in the relationship will end definitely in case of dissolution of firm. In case of dissolution of partnership, the assets and liability are revalued and new balance sheet is drawn. In case of dissolution of partnership, again I am repeating, the assets and liability are revalued and new balance sheet is drawn. But in case of dissolution of firm, the assets are sold and realized and liabilities are paid up. Dissolution of partnership, we prepare revaluation account to find out profit or loss on revaluation. And in case of dissolution of firm, we prepare realization account. This is a very important comparison. In case of dissolution, we prepare realization account. In case of dissolution of firm, in case of dissolution of partnership, we prepare revaluation account. Very, very important differences. In case of dissolution of partnership, it is voluntary and dissolved by mutual agreement. Because in case of dissolution of firm, it may be voluntary, may be compulsory. A firm can be dissolved by the court also. And that's very important. But in case of dissolution of partnership, the partner may dissolve on their own. So the dissolution of partnership changes the mutual relations of the partner, but in case of dissolution of firm, all relationship and constant and already have discussed. The business ceases to exist in case of dissolution of because all the affairs are wound up by selling the asset, already I have discussed. But in case of dissolution of partnership, it is not wound up. This is an important difference between dissolution of partners and dissolution of firm. This already I have discussed. Again, I am telling in detail. Dissolution of firm takes place by the various ways. By dissolution of agreement, it is section 40 of Partnership Act 1932. The firm may be dissolved at any time with the agreement with the consent of other partner. Number two, by compulsory dissolution, a firm is completely dissolved by operational law. All partners except one become insolvent. One of the partner become insolvent, or all of the partner become insolvent, or business become illegal, or as per the norms of the legality of the norms, more than 20 in case of ordinary business, 10 in case of banking, then also compulsory dissolved by law. And dissolution having a certain contingency, I have already discussed. Dissolution by having a certain contingency means the expiry of the term is over, the completion of the project, a firm is insolvent, and dissolution at will. And the firm is dissolved by partner a notice giving to at will, dissolution of court, the partner become unsound mind, partner is incapable of performing duty, already I have discussed. Guilty of any misconduct, a partner conduct himself in such a way that it is not possible for the other partner to carry on the business with him, and the partner transfer his interest or set to third party. Business cannot be carried on except on a loss, and when it appears to be just and equitable, for instance, continuing quarreling, deadlock in the management, refusal to attend matters of business, absence of cooperation, etc. among the partner, the court has wide discretion power to close the business. These are all the modes of dissolution of firm. How to settle the account is a very important topic. After discussing dissolution of partnership, dissolution of firm, and how the modes of dissolution of firm, how to settle accounts from dissolution. Settling accounts of dissolution, very important, because the firm is dissolved, it ceases to transit normal business. Normal business cannot take place because it is dissolved. The mode of settlement of accounts between partners after the dissolution is determined by the partnership deed takes place. In absence of any specific agreement to the mode of settlement account after the partner dissolution of deed, the partnership deed has a specific provision for settlement of accounts. What is the mode of settlement account after dissolution firm is mentioned in the partnership deed? Specifically, if they made some changes, then very good and fine, we have to follow that. But if never mentioned, then what are the Partnership Act has, as for section 48 relating to settlement of accounts, we have to follow that. What are the first? Losses, including deficiency of capital, shall be paid first out of profit. Any loss should be paid out of profit. Second, if the next out of capital. And last, if necessary, partner individual in the profit sharing ratio. If the loss is insufficient, then you have to bear the deficiency capital out of capital, and at the last out of partners sharing profit sharing ratio. You have to bear the loss, you have to pay up that. Second, the asset of the firm, including any sum contributed to the partner to make up deficiency of capital, should be applied in the following manner or order. How the asset should be set up against the liability or against the debt in relation to outside party and other parties who have taken any loan or debt from the organization of the firm. In paying the debt of the firm to third party, first the third party you have to pay the debt, what is the debt in there. In paying each partner relative what is due to him for the firm for advance, and in advance they have given. In paying to each partner relatively what is due to him on account of capital, any capital they have contributed, you have to pay them. The surplus when any dividend partner in the profit sharing ratio. The last, if there any surplus is there, you have to divide him on the profit sharing ratio. If there is no surplus, nothing, then it cannot be divided, cannot be provided to the. Here, another thing before starting firm debt and personal debt, I will tell one thing. How dissolution before expiry of fixed term takes place. If a partner on admission in the firm has paid a premium इसमें सेक्शन 30, दिस इज एक्सपर सेक्शन, सॉरी सेक्शन 50, सेक्शन 50 ऑफ द पार्टनर्स एक्ट 1932, डिसोल्यूशन बिफोर एक्सपायरी ऑफ अ फिक्स्ड टर्म, अ फिक्स्ड टर्म इज नॉट एक्सपायर्ड, बिफोर दैट यू कैन डिसॉल्व, हाउ यू कैन डिसॉल्व, दिस इज वेरी यूनिक कांसेप्ट. If a firm, sorry, if a partner on his admission in the firm has paid a premium, a goodwill, to other partner with a stipulation that the firm will not be dissolved before the expiry of certain period, they will be entitled to a suitable refund of the premium if the firm is dissolved before the term is expired. This is a very new concept. A partner has been admitted in the admission and he has paid some goodwill and there is a, he has made some condition that the firm cannot be expired before the expiry of the term. And here the firm is expired before expiry of the term, and there has been there is a clause, if the firm will be expired before expiry of the clause, the new partner was brought in goodwill and paid premium for the goodwill has to be provided suitable refund of the premium. If the dissolution takes place before expiry of a certain period, then you have to be provided that. However, no claim in respect will arise. Other claims should not be arise, like the firm is dissolved with death of a partner. These are the exceptions. The dissolution is mainly to a partner claiming refund or own misconduct. This cannot be take place. The dissolution is a result of agreement containing no provision for return of premium or any other part. But the refund of the premium will be in such as reasonably regarding terms upon which the admission was made and the length of period agreed and the period expired after the dissolution date. Any refund of premium that becomes due on the dissolution will be debited to other partner capital account in the profit sharing ratio and credited to the refund claiming partner capital account. So this is a very unique concept. The dissolution before expiry of fixed term, section 50 of Partnership Act 1932, can take place. The admission partner who has paid the premium, he should be provided a refund of that. Next concept, firm debt and personal debts. Another unique, very, very unique concept, because there are partnership debt and private debt. Partner owned debt, that is known as a private debt, and the firm debt, who is the partners also taken on the firm name. In the individual capacity, what they have taken, that is private debt. And the firm capacity, what they have taken, that is known as firm debt. So how to distribute them, how to calculate them, very, very important. The debt owed both the firm and the partners individually, the rule is under section 49. What is the rule? To apply the firm asset first. If there is a firm debt, do first to apply the firm asset paying in the firm debt. Whatever debt is there, you pay the debt from the firm asset. And out of the surplus left, each partner's share should be applied in meeting the personal debt. Any surplus left, whatever the partners they have, they are liable, they will be liable for the personal debt. To apply the private property of each partner, first pay of the personal debt and first pay of the personal debt, and any residue, any leftover, is applied to pay of the firm debt. First, the private property of the partner will be liable to the private debt of the partner, and if there is surplus left, then the firm debt will be paid out of that also. So, in case of firm debt, first firm, then partner, and in case of personal debt, first personal, then firm. And there's a difference also. I have the slide on the last aspect, but I will tell here: firm debt and private debt. Firm debt are incurred by the firm, and the private debt are incurred by partner on his individual capacity. Firm debt here on a firm debt, the difference is that all partners are jointly and separately liable. This is a common thing. In case of private debt, only concerned partner is liable, the partner who is liable for that. In case of firm debt, firm property will utilize first from the firm debt. But in case of private debt, share of partner concerned in excess of firm property over firm debt can be used. In case of firm debt, only the excess of private, already I have told, excess of private partner profit over the private debt can be used. In case of private debt, private property shall be used first. So this is a very, very important concept. And this is relating to realization account. We know the realization account is always prepared in case of dissolution of partners. Devaluation, we know it is prepared in case of admission, retirement, death of a partner. So when a business is discontinued, the firm shall be dissolved. As a result, all accounts are closed. It is therefore necessary to open realization account, cash account, bank account, and partners account. Realization account is open for all transactions relating to realization of asset and demand of liability. And that is on dissolution, it is essential to make sale of assets of the firm, realize cash, and pay up the liability. Realization of assets and settlement of liability are centered around the realization account. It is a nominal account. The difference between gain or loss will be transferred to capital account. Cash bank account is open to record all with the cash transaction. And the purpose is over, the cash account shows a balance which is equal to the amount due to partners. Capital account are open to make all entities connected with the partner capital account. Current account, if any, are transferred to capital account. Finally, the capital account are transferred by receiving or paying cash. Before going to the golden rules, I will also make two, three differences. I'll tell you two, three differences between realization account and revaluation account. Realization account, I know it is prepared at the time of dissolution of a firm. Revaluation account is prepared at the time of retirement, admission, and death of one. The realization account record book value and realized value of assets and liability. And revaluation account record increase or decrease in value of assets and liability. Realization account contain entry for expenses on dissolution, but in case of revaluation, it contain entry for the expenses incurred on revaluation of assets and liability, not for any partner admission, retirement, death. In case of realization account, profit or loss due to this effect is distributed among all the partners. In case of revaluation account, profit or loss revalued is distributed among the old partner entitled for it. There are six golden rules also dealing with the problem of dissolutions. The balance sheet on the date of dissolution is not given in the question. First of all, the balance should be prepared in proper form. It's a very important rule. Second rule, at the time of dissolution of firm, balance of accounts given in balance sheet are once Sony realization account or partner loan account or partner capital account of cash bank account, but the transaction given outside balance sheet are shown twice in said mentioned account. Third, all asset must be sold up or the other way disposed of. Fourth, all creditor must be paid. Partners who contributed beyond the capital partner loan must be included in this category. Fifth, the amount due to each partner must be paid. Sixth, the amount total of the amount both of the cash and bank account must be paid. Before coming to the insolvency, I will tell you that some general entries of which is there for the dissolution, then we'll go for a practical problem also. What are the entries on dissolution? We know the firm is closed in the dissolution, so books of accounts should be closed. The books of account can be closed only if the asset are realized in cash, otherwise or dispose of all outstanding liability are paid up. The partner loans and capital. The balance sheet is prepared on the date. The dissolution of firm takes place to know the book value of assets and liability of the firm on that date. And following steps are necessary to close the books of account. First, for closing the asset account, what is the entry? Realization account debited to assets account individually. Second, for closing the liabilities account, all liabilities account debited, like sundry creditor account debited, bill payable account debited, partners wife's loan account debited, bank overdraft account debited, outstanding expense account debited to realization account. Third, for realizing asset account, cash account debited, because asset may be either sold for cash or may be taken over by any kind of partner. If it is in cash, then asset account debited to realization. If taken over by partner or taken over by any creditor in full or part payment of the amount due to him, then it may be partner capital account debited to realization. Fourth, for payment of liability, first of all, payment of liability third party will be met and entry is realization account debited to cash or bank account. And if realization has been debited in place of liability account and partner needs to pay the liability to third party, then it will be realization account debited to partner capital account. Fifth, for expenses of realization, realization account debited to cash or bank. And if partner agreed to bear all the expenses of realization, the realization account debited to partner capital account. Sixth, for closing the realization account, you have to make the realization account debited to partner capital account. And for payment of partner loan account debited to cash or bank. And at last, to close the current account. If current account shows credit balance, then partner current account to partner capital account or vice versa. And closing the capital account, cash bank account debited to partner capital account. And last, the amount due to partner is paid and entries partner capital account to the cash or bank. Coming to the insolvency of a partner, the capital account of the partner must show debit balance because of excess withdrawal or loss on account of dilution or some other reason. Such a debit balance is known as capital deficiency. If the capital account of a partner shows a debit balance as a result of various entries passed on account of dissolution of the firm, it is expected that he will pay the money from the estate. If this is done, the other partners will be liable to get in full what is due to them. If the partner is insolvent, he will have to look good such capital deficiency by bringing cash. But if the partner is unable, he may not be able to pay off even his own private liabilities. In some cases, after paying the private liability, a small sum which is lesser than the amount due to the firm may be given by the partner whose capital account shows a debit balance. When a partner is insolvent, then such a capital deficiency will be lost to other solvent partner. For example, if there are two partners in a firm and one of them is insolvent, then the capital deficiency will be borne by the other partner, which is solvent. That will go with the solvency rules. When there are more than two partners, then arises problem as to this, which the capital deficiency will be borne by the remaining partner. In such a case, the deficiencies shown by the solvent partner capital account would be divided among the solvent partner in the ratio which is already agreed upon by them. There will go into detail with the decision of Garner and Murray, which laws will be carried on by Justice. That decision was historic decision. Justice Joyce, upholding the contention of Murray, the capital deficiency of solvent partner is capital loss and is shared with the solvent partners in capital ratio before dissolution. What are the main points? The main points of Garner Murray decision is that loss due to insolvency is capital loss. Such loss due to insolvency to be shared by solvent partner in the capital ratio just before dissolution. The loss which arises, it will be shared by solvent partner. Insolvent partner loss should be arranged by solvent partner in the capital ratio before dissolution, just before dissolution. All solvent partners will bring in the share realization loss in cash. If a partner capital accounts is a debit balance, he need not set the capital loss of the insolvent partner. They must have a carried balance. It is noteworthy to note that decision in Garner versus Murray violates the principle of natural justice and equity. For example, a partner is having a debit balance of capital account on the relevant date just prior to dissolution, he will not get the loss on account of insolvency of partnership. Even he may be financially more sound as compared to other partners. This decision is criticized because before just one day before that date of the dissolution, he doesn't have a debit balance, then he will not pay. Even if he may be financially sound throughout the year. And this is the application of rule of Garner and Murray. The partnership in 1932 has no objection regarding decision in Garner versus Murray. This is a very important theory question for all the students. In the absence of any rule or instruction, the rule should be followed by attempting the question. But the solvent partner may not be required to bring the loss on realization in cash because this amount is paid back to the solvent partner. It is against the principle of accountancy. Hence, the debit balance of solvent partner capital account deficiency should be divided among the solvent partner and the ratio of the capital. But in examination question, this is very important for the students, specifies that the rule in Garner Murray is to be applied. The solvent partner should bring in, will be required to bring the loss on realization in cash, otherwise not. Application of Garner versus Murray rule in India, the rule of Garner is applicable in India only if there is no agreement to the contrary and the partners, the capital of partners are not in profit sharing ratio. And there must be capital deficiency in the partner capital account. And when all the partners become insolvent or insolvency of partner take place, when the partner become insolvent, the creditor will not be able to get the amount in full in such a case. Outside liability are not to be transferred to realization account, but it is shown separately in a respective account. At the time of accounting treatment, the following points should be taken into consideration. The cash account should be prepared after realization account. After recording the amount realized from asset together with the amount which is received from the estate of the partner in cash account, first realization expenses to be paid and the remaining balance will be paid retroactively to the creditor. Thus, cash account shows a zero balance. After that, balance of creditor's account which cannot be paid should be transferred to the credit side of delivery efficiency account. Similarly, partner loan will be treated. At the end, debit balance of partner capital account should be transferred to credit side of efficiency account and vice versa. Both side of deficiency account must be equal. This about the insolvency of a partner, which is very, very important. And the journal entry, everybody knows, solvent partner current account debited to insolvent partner capital account. The Garner Murray decision is very, very important. The theory part is very, very important. Then comes the piecemeal distribution. Till now, we have discussed the journal entry for dissolution. What is dissolution of firm, dissolution of partnership, and what is firm debt, what is private debt, what is realization, what is revaluation, and dissolution of partnership, and what is the difference between dissolution of partnership and dissolution of firm, and how to make settlement of account on dissolution, modes of dissolution of firm, and dissolution before expiry of a term. And application of Garner Murray decision, non-application of Garner Murray decision is very, very important. Then come to piecemeal distribution. This, how the partner, when the partners are insolvent, how they are provided as per the piecemeal distribution. That is known as gradual realization of asset and piecemeal distribution. In all the problems of dissolution we have discussed, the assets are realized immediately on the date of dissolution, and accounts are creditor and partners are settled on the same date. But the assumption is unrealistic because normally the process of realizing asset takes a long time. The process, actually the sale of asset gradually, unless the business is sold to buyer or vendor. The dissolution process takes some time during which the period assets are gradually realized. This is because assets are sold piece by piece. That's why this method is known as piecemeal distribution. And the realization of asset will be slow and gradual. Similarly, the liability are paid gradually depending upon which amount realized from the sale of asset. You cannot at all sell the asset and at all pay the liability at once on a particular day. The final results are known only when the assets are completely realized and the liability are completely discharged. On realization of asset, the cash realized distributed in the following order: payment of realization expenses. First, payment to outside liability in the creditor, overdraft, bills payable, outstanding expense, etc. Payment to partner's loan or advance, payment of partner balance in capital account, like this. After making payment to outside liability and partner loan, the capital of the partners are returned. Unless the profit or loss on realization is known, the amount payable to partners cannot be ascertained, cannot be determined. If it is so, it means the partners should not be paid till the realization is complete. This creates a problem. This is because the profit or loss on account of realization is to be credited or debited to partners' capital account. It is also necessary to see that partners have been paid and the unpaid balance of each partner being a loss must be in the ratio of profit or loss during profit sharing ratio. It is therefore necessary to find out a method by which the partners are paid as and when the cash is received without waiting till the realization of asset, and at the same time to ensure that no partner is paid in excess and amount left unpaid are in the profit sharing ratio. So this is the concept of piecemeal distribution, how they are paid and how they identified. It is an universally accepted practice that an interim distribution is meant to partner for the claim after paying all the creditors as and when the cash is available. And you know the case, the gradual realization of asset takes place. It is necessary to avoid the unpleasant consequence of partner capital being overdrawn distributing cases of various realization of asset in such a way that the first unpaid balance of capital of each partner is left in the profit sharing ratio. And coming to the basis of distribution, how the distributed relation of assets or cash are distributed. The firm decide to make distribution of cash as an unreceived. There is a problem on determination of basis and ratio in which the available cash may be distributed, keeping share of loss to each partner profit sharing ratio, the capital contribution balance capital account of the partner may be not be in the profit sharing ratio. The ultimate realization loss cannot be ascertained when the distribution of cash is made on interim basis. In such a case, when the partner is not in a profit sharing ratio, whenever ratio is followed, the loss by the partner will not be in profit sharing ratio. We'll see, we'll go for the illustration 17 is there. Let's focus on that theory first. Out of the available cash, as mentioned above, the distribution of cash may come in the following manner. First, outside liability have to be paid. Second, partner loans and advance have to be paid. Third, and last, the partner's capital have to be paid. Therefore, the capital of partner are not in profit sharing ratio, then in order to make the partner loss in relation in the profit sharing ratio and to make equitable distribution of cash on piecemeal basis without affecting the interest of partner, either of the following two methods can be adopted. One is surplus capital method or proportionate capital method. The second is maximum possible loss. What is surplus proportionate method? We should note what is that surplus proportionate method. With the capital of partner and the ratio of the profit sharing arrangement, then each of them is paid out according to the capital ratio at each distribution. If the capital of the partner are not in profit sharing ratio, then the first cash available after making payment of outside liability loan due to the partner for distribution among the partners should be paid to partners whose capital are more than the profit sharing ratio to bring the capital into the profit sharing ratio level. After this, the cash available is distributed among the partner according to profit sharing ratio. Already have told, in case of surplus capital method or proportional capital method, when the capital of a partner not in ratio and partner who has contributed more than the proportional share of capital is paid first in priority to the other partner. For this purpose, the surplus capital account has to be found on the basis of profit and loss sharing ratio. Initial payment to be made in such a way that the partner of all the capital adjusted to the profit sharing ratio, and this is done, the partner will be in proportion to the profit sharing ratio. That is the different steps. First step, divide undisturbed profit in any among the partner in profit sharing ratio. practical problem on this piecemeal distribution and the two methods of piecemeal distribution doesn't come really on the examination, but the theory is very important. Divide undistributed profit, if any, among the partner in profit sharing ratio. Pay up realization expenses, make a provision for it. Pay up outside liability if the amount is insufficient, then apportionment the amount in the ratio of the claim. After paying up the outside liability, pay up partner's loan when more than two partners are there and available cash is insufficient. Then apportionment the amount in the ratio of the claim. Now partners' capital are to be refunded. Find out the amount payable to partners whose capitals are relatively in excess of their profit and loss sharing ratio. The excess amount have been paid off, the ratio of remaining balance of the capital account and the profit loss sharing ratio are one and the same. To find out the excess capital, the following steps are needed. Partner actual capital are divided with the respective ratio figures. Take the relatively lowest capital as the base and find out the notionally adjusted capital. Find out the excess of capital by comparing actual capital and notional capital. Repeat this above steps till number thereof reduced to one partner. Then start paying off from the last ultimate excess first, then preceding excess till all the expenses paid off. Then the balance, the unpaid capital loss between the profit sharing ratio, gradually the unpaid balance will be lost and realized. This is the step on how you make payment piece by piece or proportionate method to the partners. The second method is on maximum possible loss. How the maximum possible loss takes place and how the partners are paid, alternative method for piecemeal distribution, cash are distributed to partner. Under this method is assumed that at every stage of realization of asset, think that the remaining unrealized assets are worthless. Therefore, at every stage, loss can be ascertained and this loss is distributed among the partner in profit sharing this. The balance in the capital account and the cash available will be equal and the cash is paid. The steps are pay off creditors first and then partner's loan amount, if any, out of the realized amount. Now the capital are there to be paid. Wherever any cash is received, find out the difference between available cash and the balance in the capital account. The difference is maximum loss. The maximum loss is distributed to capital accounts in profit sharing ratio. That is, from the capital account, the share of loss are deducted. Now distribute the available cash among the partner according to the capital account as adjusted above. The cash available equals the sum of partner adjusted credit balance. If any partner's capital shows a debit balance, then write off according to Gandhan Mure ruling. As and when further realizations are made, the cash is distributed. The above procedure to follow in all subsequent payments among the partner. So the amount available for distribution of partner is compared with the total amount of capital payable to partner, and the maximum loss is ascertained on the assumption that in future asset will not realize any amount. And this is the way on which maximum possible loss is computed and repeated on each stage: first stage, second stage, third stage, fourth stage, like that. This is the difference. I've told again, you can go through it. Farm debt, then incurred by the farm. Private debt, then incurred by partner in individual capacity. Farm debt, they are jointly and severally liable. Private debt, only concerned partner is liable. Farm debt, farm property will be utilized first for the farm debt. Private debt, for this debt, only share of concerned partner in excess of farm property over farm debt can be used. Farm debt, for this debt, only the excess of partner private property over this private debt can be used. Private debt, for this debt, private property can still be used. And this is a difference between realization and revaluation. I have told two, three. We'll go over this detail. Realization account is prepared at the time of dissolution of farm. Revaluation account is prepared at the time of admission, retirement, death of a partner. Realization account records the book value and the realized value of assets and liability. A revaluation account records increase or decrease in value of assets and liability. Realization account main purpose to realize the assets of the farm and utilize the amount in payment of liability of farm. A revaluation account main purpose is to revalue the assets and liability of farm on admission, retirement, death of a partner in order to ensure that no partner benefits suffer due to change in partnership. Realization account profit loss due to this affected distribution among all the partners. But in case of revaluation, the profit loss on revaluation is distributed, thus revealed is distributed among the partners and the old partner entitled for it. The profit loss after revaluation, what the old partners entitled, they should be distributed. real estate account contains an entry for the expenses, and revaluation doesn't contain entry for expenses. It contains entry for expenses only for revaluation of assets and liability. A revaluation account records the effect of valuation of various assets and payment of various liability. After opening this account, all accounts in the ledger are closed. There is a winding off. In case of revaluation account, it records the effect of revaluation of assets and liability. The firm continues after opening this account. And this is the treatment of goodwill on digitalization. No special treatment is given to goodwill. It is treated like another asset. That was very important treatment goodwill has got in case of admission or retirement. But here, no special treatment is given. It treated like any other asset. It appears in the books on the digitalization date. It is closed by transferring to the debit side of digitalization account. Cash bank account debited to digitalization account. It doesn't appear in the books of the digitalization date and some amount realized for goodwill. The entry is like this. Cash bank account debited to realization. Treatment of unrecorded assets and liability, it is quite possible that on date there may be some unrecorded assets and liability. When the time of resolution arises, some asset or liability may not be recorded, may have forgotten by the accountant, and they're not appearing in the books. Then assets and liability may have a question arises to this to transfer to realization account. Arises, not arises. Entries are recorded when assets and liability are realized or paid. When unrecorded asset is realized, the entries cash bank account debited to realization. When unrecorded liability is paid, in realization account debited to cash or bank account. This illustration one, when general ledger had to be prepared, we'll go through the problem, the very, very important problem. Along with, we have the books of accounts, the general entry. This is, this cover all the aspects. Jyoti and Vikas were equal partners in the manufacturing business. On June 30, 2018, they dissolved the firm on which date the balance sheet was as follows. The liability is given, credit to 28,000, less reserve for discount 1,000, reserve for contingency is 5,000, and because Mrs. Vikas loan 10,000, reserve fund 15,000, Jyoti loan 8,000, Jyoti's capital account 21,000, Vikas capital account 18,000, the total of the liability side is 1,04,000. The total of the asset side is also 1,04,000, cash at bank is 2,500, debtors 42,000, less provision is 2,000, it comes 40,000. Stock is 32,000, furniture 3,500, plant and machinery 25,000, prepaid expenses 1,000. The total of the asset comes to 1,04,000. Stock, debtors, plant, machinery, and goodwill will realize 27,000, 38,000, 20,000, 5,000 respectively. Furniture did not realize any value. An amount of rupees 6,000 was paid on account of contingency liability. The expenses of realization were 1,000. The firm had previously made some investment in shares of joint stock company, and the return of investment on finding out useless. The investment on realization is 1,500. Close the books of the firm and show the necessary ledger account. Already I have told the ledger account, 9 ledger accounts. The journal entry first for closing the assets, then closing liability, then realizing the asset. The payment of liability, then the expenses of realization, closing realization account, payment of partner loan, closing of current account, and closing capital account. So we'll make the following general entry. See the general entry. Already it is told that is debtor account is 42,000. So what are the account balances that you put the debtor account 42,000? Stock is given balance is 32,000. Debtor second and book value don't. Take the provision. Provision will be made a separate entry. The furniture is given 3,500. Plant is given 25,000 and prepaid expense given 1,000. So, realization account debited to all assets. First, asset realization account debited to all assets in individual and book value. So, realization account debited to debtors, to stock, to furniture, to plant machinery, to prepaid expense commence 1,03,500. Then our liability, all liability creditors account debited 28,000, given in balance sheet, reserve for contingency 5,000, provision of doubtful debt which was there in debtors it is 2,000, Vikas loan is 10,000. These are all the liabilities, this liability to be taken out. To realization account is coming as 45,000. Realization account account debited to reserve for discount of creditors which is there on the liability side, you have to put that is 1,000. Reserve fund. It is given 15,000 distributed equally between Jyoti capital account and Vikas capital account. Reserve fund account debited to Jyoti capital account 7,500 to Vikas capital account 7,500. Total comes at 15,000. Bank account debited to realization account. Realize the bank account What is the bank bank account debited to stock? Already realized 27,000, debtors 38,000, and goodwill 20,000, and 5,000 is plant and machinery 20,000, goodwill 5,000, and investment which is realized nothing, that is 1500, and now realized. Bank account debited to realization account, that comes 91,500. Realize how to make payment of the asset. We have to make payment of 43,000. Realization account debited to bank. Creditor is 27,000 after the discount. Then contingency, contingent liability is 6,000. Loco Bikas loan, Mrs. Bikas loan is 10,000. 43,000. We have to make payment of the cash we have received. The expenses is 1,000. Realization account debited to bank 1,000. 1,000. Then we make the total of the credit side and debit side. The debit side is more, the credit side will less, so it comes 12,000. So there is a loss of realization. Equally, you have to distribute. Jyoti capital account debited 6,000, because capital account debited 6,000, to realization account 12,000. Then payment of Jyoti loan. Jyoti loan remaining capital. If you make the account, the next slide it is given, the capital will be. And the capital will be Jyoti capital account debited, because capital account debited to bank account 22,500, 19,500 to 42,000. See the ledger account. After the journal entry, you prepare the ledger account of realization account, capital account, and bank account. In case of realization account, first you put the journal entry, creditor account debited 28,000 to realization, so by creditor, realization, by provision for doubtful debt 2,000, by reserve contingency 5,000. By Vikas loan 10,000, the bank account realized 51,500. And there is a loss also 6,000. That will be carried on the last stage. And the debtor account, relation account of debtor 42,000, to stock 32,000, to furniture 3,500, the plant machinery 25,000, to prepaid expenses 1,000, to reserve for discount on creditor. Bank is 42,000, reserve for discount 1,000, to bank realization loss 1,000, total update is 1,48,500, deduct on the credit side. The balance left is 12,000. It should be distributed between Jyoti and Vikas. That's a loss on realization transfer to capital account of Jyoti and Vikas, 6,000, 6,000 each. Then you prepare the capital account. The two partners, Jyoti and Vikas. The balance brought down is given as 21,000 and 18,000 in the balance sheet. The reserve fund is transferred 7,500, 7,500. Total of the credit side is 28,500. Realization loss is 6,000. The balance left is to bank account. They have to pay 22,500 of Jyoti and Vikas 19,500. Last, prepare a bank account. By realization account, 43 liability has been paid. And by realization account loss, by realization account expense 1,000, by Jyoti loan 8,000, by Jyoti capital account 22,500, Jyoti Vikas capital account 19,500, total 94,000 minus. The asset realized 91,500. Bank balance brought down already there. 2,500 bank account is there in the balance sheet, and total account is closed. And this is another account which we will prepare. Another problem is situation 9, our Ram, Rahim, and Robert. The first one tells us about the stages of journal entry for realization and how the realization journal entries are passed, how the loss is calculated, how a payment is made to the loan account of the partner's wife capital account, partner's capital account, and how the capital is transferred, and how to prepare the realization account, the ledger account, realization account, and capital account, and bank account, etc. How the accounts are settled. Coming to the institution 9, this is a very important thing. How the insolvency process will take place, we will discuss in institution 9, because in case of dissolution, there is two important aspects. One is dissolution entries and insolvencies. Ram, Rahim, and Robert are partners of the firm, are traders for the past 5 years. Partners of the firm are traders. The partner decided to dissolve the firm, consequent to insolvency of the partner, Robert. The three partners, Robert, become insolvent in October 2018. Balance sheet of the firm is on 31st, 10, 2018, is furnished below. This profit and losses equally. Building asset, land and building 5 lakh, plant and machinery 2 lakh, furniture fitting 50,000, stock in trade 3 lakh, debtor is 5 lakh, cash at bank or cash at hand is 50,000, total of asset is 16 lakh. Total of liability is also 16 lakhs. Capital account of Ram is 4 lakh 50,000, Ram 4 lakh 50,000, Robert 2 lakh, general ledger 2,10,000, creditor 2,90,000. The partner capital Ram and Rahim decided to form a new firm, RR Enterprises, and take over the assets liability of firm and values given below. Land and building 3,50,000, plant and machinery 1,50,000, furniture and fittings 20,000, stock in trade 22 lakh, debtors include 3 lakh due from SN loan owned by Robert. Nothing is recovered from the said firm. Other debtors can be recovered fully. Repair the real estate account, partner capital account, books of RR Traders and balance sheet of RR Enterprise immediately after commencement. See the real estate account. First, you realize all the asset and put to all the asset total sundry asset is 16 lakh. Creditor by creditor 2 lakh, it is given in the question in the balance sheet. By the purchase consideration is given by Robert debtors 3 lakh. And by RR Enterprise, the the purchase consideration is calculated to be 6,80,000. The debtors is given as 3 lakh. The total of the debit minus total of credit, the loss is there. On the credit side, there is a loss transfer capital account. Equally, Ram, Rahim and Rohib, 3,30,000 is there, 1,10,000 each. Then open a capital account. Capital account is very important. Ram, Rahim and Robert. By balance brought down, your Ram is 4,50,000, Rahim 4,50,000, Robert is 2 lakh. By general ledger of Ram 70,000, Rahim 70,000 and Robert 70,000. General ledger was given 2,10,000, distributed equally between three. The cash is given 1,10,000, 1,10,000 and Robert is dissolved. So capital account debit to realization 1,10,000 on debit side, 1,10,000, 1,10,000. Then there are capital, Ram capital is 70,000 and Rahim capital is 70,000, that is good. Capital account debited to Robert capital, capital account debited to Ram capital, capital account debited to Rahim capital. So capital account debited to under Ram, it is put to Robert capital, and Rahim to put Robert capital 70,000. And on the credit side, in the Robert by capital account by Ram and by Rahim, because Robert is insolvent partner, 1,40,000. Insolvent partner capital account will be borne by the solvent partner, Ram and Rahim equal. That entry is passed, then you have to prepare the balance sheet. Total, all our total balance, Ram is 630,000, Ram is 630,000, Robert is 4,10,000, and both debit and credit are the capital account. Balance sheet of RR Enterprise, cash in hand at bank is 2,70,000. It is given 2,70,000, and stock in trade is 2 lakh, debtor is 2 lakh, it is given in the balance sheet. After the revaluation figure, the revaluation figure, stock in trade is 2 lakh. Debtor is 2 lakh, land and building is given as 3,50,000, land and building 3,50,000, plant and machinery 1,50,000, furniture fitting 20,000. The creditor is given 2,90,000, and the balance left is 4,50,000, which is there and given in the capital account of the two balance carried down, and that comes 9 lakh. Total of the asset, total of the liability is balanced, it is 11,90,000, 11,90,000. Coming to the different methods of insolvency, when all the partners are insolvent, point is that when outside liability are not transferred to realization account, then following procedure are followed. First, sundry assets are taken, then realization of asset, then realization expenses, then liability if secured, then liability paid on priority basis to the extent of realization of asset taken to security. Then unsecured outside liability are not transferred to realization account, but a separate account is prepared. Amount brought by any partner from the private asset estate is credited to capital account and debited to cash account. Cash account is prepared in order to calculate the amount available for payment to unsecured outside liability. The balance in unsecured outside liability represents amount not paid to this creditor and closed by transfer to deficiency account. Capital account, after all entries are transferred to balance to deficiency account, then deficiency account, if any, will be prepared. If the effect of realization of assets liability passed to realization account, and in case outside liability are also transferred to realization account, then outside liability are paid with the amount payable for unsecured outside liability, which can be ascertained by preparing cash. Secured creditors to the extent of realization of security are always paid on priority basis as compared to unsecured creditors. The realization loss is transferred to capital.
Again, sir, PPT bond kar di chandi ji.
PPT bond hi nahi. The real estate loss is transferred to capital account, and the balance in capital account are transferred to deficiency account. Deficiency account when prepared with tally, and this will be very, very clear for if the effect of relation of all assets and liability past the real estate. Already we discussed regarding the methods of visualization in case of piecemeal distribution. There are two methods already we have discussed, and there are two methods you know, that is proportional method and maximum possible loss method. That is very important for piecemeal distribution. And the Gardner-Murray decision, where it is not applicable, the last point I will tell, non-applicable to Gardner-Murray rule, when the solvent partner is a debit balance in the capital account, only solvent partner will be at the loss of capital deficiency insolvent partner in the capital ratio. If incidental solvent partner has a debit balance in the capital account, he will escape the liability to be at the loss due to insolvency of other partner. And when the firm has only two partners, then also the Gardner-Murray rule not applicable. And there is agreement between the partners to share the deficiency capital account or insolvent partner, there also it is not applicable. And all the partners of the firm are insolvent, then also it is not applicable. And we know there are two capital account, fixed and fluctuating capital account. While determining the capital ratio of the solvent partner, distinction should be observed between fixed and capital account. If the partners of the capital of the partners are agreed to be fixed, then no adjustment is required for accumulated profit or losses, interest on capital, drawing and deficiency of insolvent partner is borne by solvent partner in proportion to the agreed capital account. All adjustment relating to accumulated profit or losses, reserve, interest and capital drawing will be recorded in the current account of the partners. The deficiency of the insolvent partner will be ascertained after transferring the balance of the insolvent partner current account to the capital account. And the deficiency of the insolvent partner will transfer to the current account of the solvent partner in proportion to the agreed fixed capital. And the entry will be solvent partner current account debited to insolvent partner capital account. And with this, we will finishing. But there is another concept of to find out the missing figure. How to find out the missing figure in case of dissolution of partnership firm. Sometimes the partner's capital and other liability are given the problem, but value of various assets or particular assets such as cash at bank is not given, or book value of various assets and liability are given, but figure of creditor is not given. In such a case, memorandum balance sheet should be prepared for calculating figure of missing assets or liability. The balancing figure on the asset side or liabilities of the balance sheet represents the amount of missing figure, such as sundry assets or creditor or balance of profit loss account or cash and bank. This is this much about today class. Thank you. Hello, Salani.
Sir. Nishant, sir.
Salani, hello.
Again. Thank you, sir. Nishant. Hello. Hello. Oh, sorry.